Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here at First Presbyterian Church in Muskegon. Whether you are here in person or whether you are worshiping with us online, we give you a hearty welcome, not because we have our act together, because sometimes we don't, right? But we can welcome everyone because Christ welcomes all of us. No matter where we are in life journey, Christ meets us and welcomes us here. And so we welcome you. I just have to say I'm kind of excited that two people who mean a lot to me are worshiping with us today. John and Karen Myers have a boat in the Muskegon Marina, and I've known them from Grand Rapids, and a special welcome to the Myers this morning. Also have a couple other announcements. As you noticed, we have a congregational meeting next Sunday after worship. The purpose of that meeting is to approve the pastoral nominating committee and to also make a few updates on our bylaws. It's also Pentecost Sunday, and you are invited to wear red to that service, and we also will be receiving new members. So it's going to be a Sunday full of much joy. Please note that we have some very special flowers this morning, and these are given by Wayne Kars and his family in memory of Monique, Wayne's beloved wife. So hope you will enjoy those this morning. Another announcement is there's a garage sale next Saturday, the Glenside garage sale. So bring your stuff, put it in the youth room, and the Faith Development Committee will be pricing those things, and all the proceeds to that will be going to our youth program. So please give generously to that. Cami asked me to remind you about the sensibility offering next week. The quarter tubes are in the back, so if you don't have one, don't forget to take one. And finally, Jim, our elder for outreach and communication, has an announcement. So,
I'm going to make an announcement here on the Walk About the Neighborhood with Pastor Lowry. It'll be on every Wednesday at 3 p.m. I found that it is a good time to talk with Lori, to get to know her, and for her to know you. I did a walk a few weeks ago, and we walked down to McGrath Park and then walked back on the other side of Wickham. As we came across a neighbor, we introduced ourselves that we were from the First Presbyterian Church, and the last lady we met on our walk needed Lori to pray for her. She was having family struggles, and Lori did have someone call on her. We now have the neighborhood prayer request cards to hand out to the neighbors we meet. There is an area on the card for them to enter their prayer request and optional lines for their name and contact information. The prayer requests can be dropped into the church's mail slot at the Wickham entrance. Please join Pastor Lori on her walk about the neighborhood by adding your name to the sign-up sheet in the narthex. And I noticed that that sign-up sheet is by the sign-up sheet that we, when we come in. So there's another sheet there to fill out. Please add your name to it and join Pastor Lori on her walk. I have a quote from the Five Practices of Fruitful Congregations that session members are reading and discussing at the session meetings. The quote is, "We see ways to create ministry inside and outside the walls of the church. This requires a different posture towards our neighborhoods, a deliberate outward focus, and a willingness to carry Christ's love to where the people already live, work, and play, rather than hoping people will come to us."
Yeah. Friends, bless you. Yeah. Let's worship God.
Thank you. the call to worship. This is the good news. The cross is empty. This is the good news. The word of God is near to us. This is the good news. Once we were not a people, now we are God's people. This is the good news. We are nourished by God's love. This is the good news. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will never put it out. To confession. God's love is strong and ever-present, yet the voices and the values of this world pull us away from grounding ourselves in God's steadfast love. Confession is a time when we acknowledge how we have strayed from God's love. As individuals and as a community, let's confess our sin to God.
Turn them into deeds. Instead of being of one heart and soul, we choose sides and form groups of people just like us. And thus, with great grace, we have trouble sharing it with those who need it most. Forgive us, God alone. Forgive us.
declaration of forgiveness. God loves us and stands ready at every moment to forgive us and once again call us God's very own. You are God's beloved, forgiven and free. Receive this good news and live it. Alleluia. Amen. As a loved and forgiven people, we are at peace with God through Jesus Christ. This is good news that is meant to be shared. So keeping COVID safety protocols in mind, show a sign of this peace of Christ with each other. May the peace of Christ be with you. The first scripture reading, Lamentations 3:19-24. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will have hope in him.
Jesus,
Our gospel reading for this seventh Sunday in Easter comes from John Gospel, chapter 21, verses 15 through 19. Let's listen for God's living word for us this morning. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time, he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." Jesus said, "Tend my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fashion your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you to where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. And after this, Jesus said to him, "Follow me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me, please? Gracious God, we ask for the grace and the wisdom and the openness to continue to listen for your word for us this day. May the words of my mouth and may the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, because you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, my dad would sometimes say, "Lori Lynn Starkweather." And whenever he used my full name, I always knew I was in trouble. Anyone relate to that? Yeah, anyone relate to that? Maybe some of us parents here have done the same thing. When we use the full birth name of our children in this way, we're communicating something important, aren't we? But it's not just in times when we're in trouble that our full names get used. We also have our full names used at other times, important times, when we're baptized, when we're confirmed, when we get married, sometimes when we're ordained for special service in the church or other places, the military, and when we die, when our remains are prayerfully left in God's hands and in the earth, we often use our full birth name. Well, here, in our text in John, Jesus uses Peter's full birth name, Simon, son of John. Now, you may remember that Jesus changes Simon's name when he is the first to say out loud that he is the Messiah. And you can read about that in Matthew 16. Jesus tells him that he will now no longer call him Simon, but he will be called Peter, which means rock. And on this rock, Jesus will build his church. But here, after the brutal crucifixion and after Christ's resurrection, after he has made breakfast for all the disciples, Jesus tells Peter, pulls him aside by himself for a one-on-one chat, and calls him not Peter, but Simon, son of John. You know, I wonder, after a couple years of hearing Jesus call him Peter, if he was a little shocked to hear his birth name. Now, we don't know if back then authority figures used full names like this when someone was in trouble, but we can guess that Peter may have been feeling a little squeamish when Jesus pulled him aside by himself. After all, making a bold assertion that he would not deny Christ, he denied being connected to him not just once, but three times the night of the crucifixion. Peter didn't even show up at the crucifixion. He was off hiding. And on the day of the resurrection, he didn't stay at the tomb with Mary. He went running back to hide. And so then Jesus pulls him aside using his full name, Simon, son of John. We almost expect maybe for a finger to come up and for Jesus to say, hey, you denied me, or maybe even to give some comfort. It's okay, I know you did this, but it's okay. But no, Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus does what Jesus often does. He asks a question. Simon, son of John, do you love me? Now we are in a series this Easter season pondering the questions of Jesus. Each week I remind us that there are 307 questions from Jesus recorded in the Gospels. Jesus wants us to search our hearts and our minds and doesn't often give us answers, but Jesus does ask us a lot of questions. And here he asked Peter a big one. Simon, son of John, do you love me? Now, most of you know, many of you know, that there are many words in the Greek for love. Greek is the original language of this text, and the word for love that Jesus uses here is agape love. Simon, son of John, do you love me in such a way that you will sacrifice for me? Because that's what agape love means, sacrificial love. Peter responds with, Jesus, you know I love you. But the word Peter uses is not agape, but phileia, which means brotherly love. It's like Peter is saying, you know I'm your friend, and I want to be with you, and I value our relationship. But he can't use the agape love word. Can't say he'll sacrifice all for Jesus at this point. Maybe because he realizes he's already denied him, and that he's a human being and can't promise what he may not be able to deliver. So Jesus says, Simon, son of John, do you agape me? Peter responds, yes, I love you, I phileia you. But Jesus doesn't seem too concerned about Peter's inability to use the agape word. He still gives him a job to do. Okay, Peter, you love me? Tend my sheep, take care of my people. And then we get this question two more times. Jesus asked Peter three times this question, which requires Peter to keep searching his heart. Most Bible scholars agree that there is so much grace in Jesus asking Peter three times to affirm his love for him, because he denied him three times, and this gives him three chances to reaffirm his love. As Bible scholar Tom Wright says, Jesus is always meeting us in our places of pain. And he does that here with Peter too. It's interesting to note that the second time Jesus asked Peter this question, he also uses the agape word. Simon, son of John, do you agape me? Do you love me? But Peter again says, Jesus, you know I love you, I phileia you. And then the third time, Jesus meets Peter where he is at. He asks the question on Peter's level and says, okay, Peter, do you phileia me? Do you love me? And Peter says that he does. Again, think about it. Jesus meets Peter where Peter is at. And Peter is honest here about the level of love he's able to give to Jesus. And Jesus meets him in that place. Think about it. Jesus calling Peter by his birth name, giving him the chance to affirm his love three times, and then meeting him in the place where Peter's heart is at. Friends, that's what our Jesus does for us too. As you ponder this question to you this morning, do you love me? You can be assured that in however you are able to answer that question, with a hearty yes, or with a, gee, I don't know, or with a yes, but, or even with a no way, Jesus will meet you in that place, because that is what Jesus does. But Jesus does more than just ask Peter to answer the question. Jesus commissions Peter to work as a response to this answer. You love me? Feed my sheep, feed my lambs. Get out there, take care of my people. Each time Jesus answers the question, each time Peter answers the question, he's given a directive to do something. Because as you know, love is more than just a feeling. When we love something or love someone, our actions are meant to reflect that love. As many of you know, Marie Olson had a stroke a little over a week ago, and she's currently at St. Mary's Hospital. She's doing really well. I'll tell you more about that during the prayer time. She will be transferred over to St. Mary Freebed this upcoming week. But her daughters have dropped everything to come and support Don and Marie. Many of you have been bringing meals to them. Don has spent each day at the hospital. They love Marie. And it's not enough to just say, I love you, Mom, or I love you, my wife. They're there for her in her time of need. The love in our hearts always generates action. A member in the Benton Harbor Church, where I pastored for many years, I'll call her Anna, as a senior citizen, lived on a monthly Social Security check of under $800. She was able to live in subsidized housing, and that woman knew how to stretch a nickel. She had done it her whole life. And while she never complained, we knew there were some months when Anna didn't have enough. Well, when the church started a capital campaign to fix the church roof and expand the entryway, Anna was one of the first to give a pledge of $25 a month for 2 years. I pulled her aside. I knew this was a huge pledge for her, and I was going to let her know, you know, gee, Anna, you don't need to do this. And I'll never forget her words. Pastor Laurie, I love Jesus, and I love this church, and I love this community, and I prayed about this, and Jesus told me this is the amount. I'll do nothing less. And as far as I know, Anna kept her pledge. You see, when we say we love someone or something, it generates action. And in Peter's case, he did go out and nurture the lives of Jesus' sheep. Actually, his love also went from phileia to agape, from brotherly to sacrificial, because as most of you know, Peter ended up being crucified for his faith and for the love that he showed for the people of God. And tradition teaches us that he insisted on being crucified upside down, as he didn't feel worthy of being crucified by his Lord. So the questions for us, friends, on this Memorial Day weekend, this day when we remember those men and women who for love of country gave their all, and we remember many who we loved, who've sacrificed for us, the question is, do we love Jesus? Now hear this question with grace, because that's how Jesus asks us this question, using our full names, not with a finger pointing at us, but wanting us to really search our hearts and answer this honestly. Do we love Jesus? And I think part of the answer to that question resides in another question. Are we aware that Jesus really loves us? Because we can't really respond if we don't know that. And we might not know if we are loved. But my hunch is that if you search your heart honestly, you will find a longing there to be loved, a place in your life where even the most loving parent or spouse is unable to touch. We all have that place. Ask our Lord to meet you in that place today and ponder this question. Hear Jesus calling you by your full birth name and asking, do you love me? But beware. As you answer that question, you will be asked to do something with that love. Whatever level or place your love is, you will be asked to do something from that place. And friends, you and I know that our world needs people now more than ever who are willing to let the love of Jesus be primary in everything. In a world where wars and rumors of wars abound, in a world where little children can get done down in school, where people of color are still afraid for the lives of their sons and daughters, and where money and power still rule the roost, yes, our world needs this Jesus kind of love more than ever. This kind of love that is willing to go where the pain is, a love that will meet people where they are at, a love that will give people grace and hope, a love that will not be content to sit back and hide in the face of injustice, and a love that will rejoice in beauty. So listen deeply to this question, my friends, this voice of Jesus. Do you love me? In this series on the questions of Jesus, we've prayed together and we've pondered these questions. Do you have something to eat? What do you want me to do for you? Who is my mother? Who is my brother? Who do you say that I am? And now this one today, do you love me? Pastor Martin Copenhaver, who's the author of the book, Jesus is the Question, emphasizes that it's important to pay special attention to the questions Jesus asks more than once. And so to end this series of sermons today, I'd like to read what Pastor Copenhaver writes about these questions that Jesus repeats. Pastor Copenhaver writes, there are three questions that Jesus repeats in the Gospels. Those three questions, read together, capture so much about what it means to encounter and follow Jesus. Jesus asks, what are you looking for? He asks, what do you want me to do for you? And he asks, do you love me? What are you looking for is a question for those who yearn for God knows what and end up concluding that they are yearning for God. What do you want me to do for you is a question asked by a Lord who acts more like a servant, eager to attend to our needs. And do you love me is a question asked by someone who wants to be in a relationship with you and is willing to become completely vulnerable in order to do so. Martin Copenhaver concludes, if you want to grasp what a life in Christ entails, repeat these three questions often and hold them close. So friends, may we continue to follow Jesus and live these questions. Amen.
Thank you.
come up. And if you want to bring Finn and Sawyer, you can, or come by yourself. Many of you know that Carly has been one of our nursery attendants. Every other week, she shares duty with Latoya Wright. And because of some family commitments and other work obligations, Carly is going to be stepping down from that role. We'll be still be seeing her and her family around the church. But anyway, I just felt like, you know, someone who serves us so faithfully, I feel like we need to give her a round of applause and say thank you. So thank you, Carly. Thank you. Thank you very much for your service. Yeah, yeah. Let's pray for Carly, shall we? Gracious God, we give you thanks for your faithful servant, Carly Ernst, and for Finn and Sawyer, and for the wonderful noises they bring of joy into our worship service. We pray that you will bless her as she and her family, as they continue discerning how to care for themselves and each other. Grow their faith and bless them, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, thank you, lady. Yeah. He's welcome to stay up here if he wants. Yeah. We're going to continue with other prayers. I know a number of you have asked about Marie Olson. For those of you who weren't aware, Marie Olson had a stroke a little over a week ago. She has been in St. Mary's Hospital and also ended up being diagnosed with COVID. The good news is, as of yesterday, she's off oxygen, which is great news regarding her COVID. She's progressing. She's still not able to eat because of the paralysis in her tongue due to the stroke, but some of her other movements are coming back, and they're going to be testing her for COVID again today or tomorrow, and as soon as she comes clear, they're going to be able to move her to Mary Freebed for rehab. Don was in tears yesterday when he mentioned that people from the church are bringing food and how much support and love he's felt. So just thank you all, Pam and the team that pulled all that together. And let's continue to lift up Don and Marie in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Also wanted you to give you an update on Wanda Bonham. Wanda was supposed to have a lumpectomy on Friday and was not able to have that because of some concerns about her heart and lungs. And when she went in for that test, they also found that there were some other concerns. So to make a long story short, she's currently at Butterworth Hospital undergoing tests for some bleeding ulcers and other things that are going on with her. So, and as you know, Jack is struggling. So let's please keep Wanda and Jack and Cammy and Scott and the whole family in our prayers. Let's lift all of them before God. For the Bonham family, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I have a note from Mark and Pam Shoemaker that Mark's brother-in-law, Jim, had a heart attack and two stents. And in a few weeks, we'll need to have bypass surgery. So let's hold Jim before God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Are there other things we should be holding before God this morning, friends, that you would like to bring? I have to say it's a joy to see Lee Kleinheskel in worship this morning. He's doing great. Yeah. Any others? Okay, let's continue in prayer. Gracious God, our hearts have been broken once again this week as we faced more violence in our nation. Please forgive us, God. Forgive us as a nation for being a place where these kind of violent things can happen, and please lead us and teach us. We pray for all of the victims' families in Buffalo, the victims' families in the church in California, and we pray for all of the residents of Uvalde, Texas, and all the victims of that terrible shooting. Pour out your spirit upon all of us. Lead us that we can truly be led by your love in all that we do. And we pray for our leaders that they will be able to act with courage and with love. On this Memorial Day, God, we also give you thanks for the men and women who have sacrificed their lives for our nation. And we pray for their families today as they remember them. And we also remember other people who have touched our lives, people whose love has made a difference in our lives and in our church and in our community. Thank you for this long, long line of love that we come from. We continue to pray for our congregation in this interim season. We pray for the Pastoral Nominating Committee, which will be formally elected next week and has already begun its work. Continue to bless and lead and guide those people, those faithful people. Mm-hmm. We continue to pray for our session and all of our leaders. We pray for our neighborhood around this community. You know the people who are here, God, and what they need. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will be meeting people in special and in new ways. And teach us how to be community and family to those around us. Finally, God, we pray for the people of Ukraine and their situation. We pray for peace. We pray for hope. And we pray for ongoing justice. Thank you for Jesus, who meets us where we're at. Fill us with your Spirit as we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
God is generous beyond measure. With thanksgiving for God's generosity in our lives, let us be generous as we offer ourselves and our resources for the ongoing ministry of Jesus Christ in the world. Offering plates are in the narthex, and congregants may contribute following worship, or contributions may be made online through our website or mailed. The prayer of dedication. We offer ourselves and our resources to you, O living Christ. May we do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, a reminder that there's coffee and cookies and a time of fellowship in the chapel. If you don't know how to get there, ask someone or follow the crowd. And we hope that you will join us to continue our worship in a time of fellowship. Also, I forgot to mention something. Check out fpcmuskegon.org. Poof, you will see the new website was launched over the weekend. So check it out. It's pretty exciting. And anyway, I meant to mention that at the beginning and forgot. Okay. That song, "Will You Come and Follow Me If I But Call Your Name?" Jesus is calling each of us by name and inviting us to follow. How will you answer that call? Receive a benediction. May God walk in front of you to lead you. May God walk behind you to protect you. May God walk underneath you to support you. May God walk beside you as your companion and guide. Do not be afraid. The presence and love of our God are with you always. Amen.